you know what kind of dinosaur uses cheap toilet paper?
What kind?
A megasaurus.
Hey, welcome back to our Stupid Ranks of the Idiots. I'm Corbin.
I'm Rick.
And you can follow us on Instagram,
Twitter,
Twitch.
Thank you for some Patreon. Follow us, shoot a cat, ring bells, gunnies, gun, boop. Twitter, where the juicy content comes out of your twat.
That's true. That's exactly
right. Your backyard. There's trees down.
The squirrel was getting on to the bird feeder through that branch, so I tore that branch down.
Oh, well, he's pissed because he's back over there now.
And I know. It doesn't stop him. There's nothing I can do to stop this squirrel.
No.
Anyways, welcome to Halloween month.
Oh!
I think we're calling it Halloween Horror Month, but...
Yeah!
I don't know if that it's gonna stick to all the films that we watched during this month. We're just gonna, in case you don't know, I've been planning this, that we're gonna watch scary / spooky / thriller, even though I know like this is not like the main genre of Indian cinema. There's not a ton of it. I know that.
Like my underscore.
Yeah, it was great.
Manson, great.
But that's what we're doing Halloween month.
As best we can.
I thought it would be good to dip into Assamese films again, because this will be, what, our fourth?
I believe that's correct.
And we're exclusively only watching two directors.
That's it. Because that's all there are.
Rima Das.
Mm-hmm.
And the one I
there's only two directors in the whole industry.
Assamese industry?
Yeah, that's it. I don't know if everyone knew that. Only two.
Say his name.
Bhaskar Hazarika.
We interviewed our dost.
Yep.
And this is a 2015, his first film ever. Kathanoli?
Sure.
Kathanoli. And it's written and directed by him.
Yeah.
And it's based off of four folktales from the Assamese culture. I'm told everyone in like that area kind of grew up with...
Would know them.
Like these folklore kind of things. And he kind of did a modernization / more, making him a little more creepy as well, and interwove them into kind of one film as well. But it's starring Seema Biswa,
mm-hmm.
Adil Hassan, the Wunderschlong.
Yep.
And a few other people.
Who I forgot was in it. So when he popped up, I was like, oh, hey.
Yeah. Say these ones.
Zarifa Wahid and Umila Mahata.
And a couple other people.
And
but
forgive mispronunciation.
I'm thinking of the four main ones that we saw. But if you haven't watched it, go watch it. Come back. This will be a 100% spoiler review. Came out in 2015. We saw it on, what was it? Movie Saints,
yeah,
which I believe is
Movie
where
Saints.
We saw his first, his second film, Amis, which we love
Amis.
Go watch that one as well. But Rick, your initial thoughts, please.
Well, the first thing I want to do is thank you. If you're watching this, that means that you are a cinema lover and you love to see everything from all of the regions, because oftentimes the ones that aren't the mainstream popular things, they tend to not get a lot of attention. So if you're watching this, kudos to you, cinema lover.
Good job.
One of the weirdest movies I've ever seen in my life, because the stories were so weird,
mm-hmm.
and I liked it.
Yeah.
I have only one gripe, and it's given with a big grain of salt as far as just extending grace, and that is, while there wasn't anything blaringly bad with acting at all,
mm-hmm.
there just wasn't anything riveting in the acting.
This was definitely much more story driven than any kind of performance
driven. The story is great. Acting was fine.
It's kind of like how his last other one was too.
Yeah,
even though those had good performances.
I found those performances to be a bit more experienced.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
that was probably what it all comes down to was just experience, probably.
Well,
but it,
not, no, some of these actors are veterans.
But what, really?
Oh, yeah. One, Adil, obviously.
Well, he's, of course.
She's in Bandit.
Yes.
She's in Bandit Queen.
Those were the two I was going to point out.
Those are the two probably most veteran, but there might be some other ones.
Nothing blaringly bad. This gets for me, and I'm almost done with my rating system. Because the way it's weighted is going to be believability and story. If you fail on believability, the movie's going to get an F, because you have to have believability. And if it's insanely over the top, straining credulity, like, then it's the entertainment value.
Like DDLJ.
Right. Yeah. Then you're not looking at believability, you're looking at entertainment value, mm-hmm. like bad stunt work. Mm-hmm. If it's intentionally bad, it's not believable, but man, it's entertaining. Yeah. So anyway, this gets, for story, mm-hmm. not only was it really original and bizarre, which mm-hmm. I'm sure we'll get into, mm-hmm. I don't know if this is intentional with the stories themselves, but I found them to be deeply profound metaphors yeah. for the struggle of women.
Yeah, well, I think that's... I think that was... I actually really enjoyed the film as well. I thought it was extremely unique. I think our Dost...
yeah, Bhaskar.
Bhaskar. He does a really good job at telling stories and unique stories.
And he's creepy.
Really good.
I love his creepiness.
He's a really good filmmaker.
Yeah.
If you haven't watched our interview, please go watch it. I thought he did a really good job.
And go watch Thomas this month.
And you could tell... being his first film, you could tell even growth from this to Amis.
You could, but for a first
but
film.
But for a first film, it's absolutely... But you could definitely tell the budgetary constraints he had.
Sure.
But that makes for some great filmmaking. Because you have to be so creative.
Yes.
Because you don't have the money to do kind of what you want.
I bring this up all the time. It's like iambic pentameter. The constraints of iambic pentameter, where you have to write 10 syllables per line in 14 lines with maybe a breath to give you an 11th thing. Those constraints actually release a creativity that wouldn't be there. And that's mm-hmm. the same thing with this kind of filmmaking. When you have a constraint of budget, constraints of time, it causes you to go outside the box, and often some of the most creative things happen with those constraints.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think he does really well, because even in Amis, he had a low budget.
Yeah.
And he did so much with
so
that.
So much with it.
And you could totally tell his growth, even though he did really well in this as well. The story was definitely the part. But yeah it's... Because it, I think somebody said they're known as grandma's stories.
Okay.
And so it's stories that parents or grandparents would tell kids.
Sure.
To try to teach them a lesson almost.
Isn't it funny that kids' stories, like Mother Goose rhymes, they're freaking twisted.
Most of them are.
Yeah.
Most of the original Mother Goose or Disney
stories. Yeah, they're twisted.
The originals are very twisted. Like, the original Cinderella, it's actually her, like, they start cutting off their own feet to try to fit into the slipper.
Right.
And so it gets really gory.
Really gory and demented.
Like, and that's how most of the, like, the Grimm fairy tales are. They're pretty dark.
And I haven't enjoyed an inanimate object that becomes animated as much since Castaway.
Yeah. It was really not. I don't know if
I started to become attached to that object.
I didn't know if it was pulled on a string.
I couldn't figure it out.
What exactly they did.
I know.
They did a really good job.
Great job.
I couldn't see a string. I couldn't see whatever they did, or if they... I don't think they CGI'd it in.
No, I don't either.
Maybe they...
I don't know if they put a remote control inside of it.
Oh, might have been a remote control ball, like they have some of those. That could be it.
Yeah, but they could have put a remote control car in it. And it still got the signal, and they could drive it, but it was flawless.
It looked like a coconut, like a green coconut tube, but I think it's like a something like a green apple or like nothing.
It's the elephant apple.
Elephant apple. That's what.
Yeah,
it is.
And it's like in tropical regions. I know they're in South America, but it's particular to this region. It's funny because Indrani ate an apple. I forgot what it's called, but she showed it to me the other day. And she opened it up, and it looked like something from outer space.
Mm.
It was, again, another interesting... Because that fruit in this, if you've seen this film, and when you see this film, never seen that before.
No, I've never seen that
We've
fruit.
Never seen that
But before. Yeah, they definitely gave you a love for this inanimate object.
Sure did.
Well, I guess not technically. It's
Well, yeah, spoilers.
So yeah. Once again, if you're still here, go watch it.
Go
please.
Watch it, because here's the rest of the spoilers. So, yeah, there's a
little boy, essentially, in there.
Well, it was a girl.
Oh, yeah, it was a girl. Sorry.
Right.
A little girl.
And I believe if she wasn't albino, she was real close.
Yeah.
Especially in the daylight. They're walking in that daylight scene.
Very white.
Very, very light skinned.
Yeah. But the way they decided to shoot it as the apple, the elephant apple, was so nice, because you're like, this is adorable. I want one.
Yeah.
I want one
to follow me around. And I started feeling bad that she got shunned. She couldn't help the fact that she gave birth to this when her husband kicks her out. I'm like, you dick. It's not her fault she gave birth to that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love that whole storyline, and then that arc, and kind of each story had its own metaphor behind it, essentially.
It did.
Like the great one, obviously, of the mom trying to kill her stepdaughter.
Unbelievable.
Great. I loved it.
This slow murder by blunt force trauma.
This is terrible.
I'm like, are they really going to break her hands and her feet?
Yeah.
Wow.
Just literally murdered her.
Yep.
For that whole thing. But, like, that one was so interesting because obviously she was kind of jealous of her for,
of course,
for the husband loving basically her more than her.
Right.
And she, I don't know if she had schizophrenia. I don't know if it was like a demon that right. was talking to possession.
No, I think the story, and it's open to interpretation. I think it lends itself to the fact that that was a demon that was
demon that was possessing her.
And yeah,
that's because at first I was like, "Ooh, that's a creepy guy," but then you're like, "Is he real?"
Right.
I don't think he's real.
I thought like this is the guy she's meeting out in the woods to have an affair with.
Uh huh.
But his eyes were so tweaked. I'm like, eyes are the window to the soul. That's not a human being. That yeah. guy is a spirit.
Yeah.
And then I thought it was cool when he just shows up while she's there and he whispers in, and he's always like smiling when he whispers mm-hmm. in her ear.
Did a really good job with that performance, that actor.
Yeah, he did.
And just the fact that once again, our Bhaskar, to tell a story in that way, and like I was saying, we are completely oblivious to any of these stories.
Don't.
So it was coming in as naive as you can be.
Yep,
really.
Clean slate.
And so it was a really unique way to tell like that style of story, to have a character like that.
Yeah.
Out of body, that's not really like a spirit or yeah. something like that. But make him, it was very believable. I
yeah.
could have believed this was a real person.
I know.
Could have believed it was a demon.
As absurd as everything was, there was a level of believability to it that kept me intrigued. It wasn't absurdist.
Yeah.
Even though it was absurd.
Yeah.
Even like...
It was like Guillermo del Toro stuff.
Exactly. It yeah. reminded me a lot of a Guillermo kind of thing that
yeah.
he would like.
Yeah.
I loved the whole reason behind... Like, when the film starts off, how do you not love the fact he's freaking burying a baby alive? I'm like, okay, this is going to be macabre. And then we get the payoff.
Oh, I did not like that book.
We get the payoff later
yeah.
of why all what the babies are like, yeah. Yeah, because if he hadn't done it at 14, I was going to poison him. Yeah, and I was going to hack him up. Thank God he buried the babies.
Yeah.
So weird,
very strange.
Yeah,
but that's that whole other story of that of the mom, because you're like, this guy killed her babies.
Yeah,
three of them. And so like you really, and then that whole, I did not expect like the babies to come out of the ground.
No,
but it was awesome.
And did you notice the one, because low budget, he did it. It was obvious it was like a baby doll.
Mm-hmm.
But the eye goo. That was great.
That was great. I really enjoyed that.
I did too.
And then what was the other one? The story of the
marriage to the
marriage
python.
The python, which is, once again, so weird. And everybody's just talking about it like it's this normal thing.
Mama, he smells. No, don't insult him like that.
It's such a weird thing, but it worked so well because you bought into the world very early on.
And it was the second marriage. Like, it didn't just happen once.
Yeah, and so, that, the whole thing was the greed of
right.
the grandma, because it at one time happened. And so they're like, yeah, now you're going to marry it because this guy's a prince.
Right, but they forced it because the other snake came into the village on its own. They forced the second one to do it. Very strange.
Very strange.
Very,
but
very
also
strange.
Very cool. A great story of obviously greed, jealousy.
Yeah, and that's what I alluded to earlier, that I think is, I don't know if these stories teach those morals and they're wrapped up this way, or if Bhaskar did them. But what I saw in this was these four vignettes doing this powerful metaphor about pretty much every kind of issue women face, from patriarchy, which the woman who they said was a witch mm-hmm. because she gave birth to the elephant apple.
Yeah.
And the way she was treated by her husband, because, and that goes into the way women are treated, whether they give them a son or a daughter, and then arranged marriages, the one with the snake, and
yeah.
then the way little girls are treated and forced labor and child. I mean, pretty much, if you really sat down, you could do a paper. This would be a great thing to do in a theater class, college level, and go, when you watch this film, pinpoint each of the issues of human rights that you see are violated by women in this, representatively or directly. And
yeah.
I bet you'd come up with like 9 or 10.
Absolutely.
Easy.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And
there's another writer on this.
Who wrote it along with Bhaskar? Arupa Patangia Kalita.
Because Bhaskar wrote the script.
And right.
And apparently the dialogue was also helped by Arupa. I wanted to mention that. But another thing, one of my favorite aspects of the film was the score.
Yeah, agreed.
Oh my word.
The score almost from the beginning.
Some of the stuff they had for the themes of some of the characters.
Fantastic.
It was like extremely creepy sounds and just strange noises. Mm-hmm. That you, almost like they used it a lot in Get Out, like the
agreed.
Like,
yeah, those weird sounds hitting on a hollow something.
I don't know what it was.
I agree.
But it worked so, so well. So,
absolutely agree.
The composer is
Amamoth Hazarika.
I thought this, it was one of my absolute favorites from the beginning to end. Especially with the stepmom that was kept killing her.
Yeah.
She had like this really creepy, and I think it was, they almost had some themes that kind of came back a bunch.
Yes.
Because of certain things. I think the demon, whenever something was coming out of her, mm-hmm. it was like a certain sound. But yeah. I thought it was really creative.
Yeah, I did too.
I like that aspect a lot.
Yeah, the only thing, and again, it's
some
acting's hard. Acting's hard, and I feel like they worked with everything they had, and it wasn't that there were bad performances. There just weren't any that were grandly riveting. This isn't a movie I'd point to say, hey, if you want to see some great acting, watch this movie.
Yeah.
But not every movie has to have that. This is a movie with great story. It's weird.
Yeah.
And for this month of Halloween where you get creepy, scary
good
stuff.
Good start, huh?
Good start.
Yeah, and I think that's probably what we're going to get most in the films is more story-driven. Because mm-hmm. Obviously the whole point of, at least here, is to scare you.
Right. Jump scares are a big deal.
Obviously, sometimes there's great performances in like Get Out and occasionally, but
and great stories.
I think normally with like the horror genre as a whole, it's more story driven than most.
It definitely is with the one who I love and is at the top of the game right now is Michael Flanagan. Mm-hmm. Both his films and his TV series are he does some of the best jump scares, which I love. And then his stories are so strong. Mm-hmm. Haunting of Hill House. If you've never seen The Haunting of Hill House and The Haunting of Bly Manor, see Hill House first. The Haunting of Hill House is, I don't want to say anything to give anything away, but the storyline, when you stay through that show and you see where it's going, it's just Michael Flanagan's really, really intelligent writer of scary stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I thought this was a great start to Halloween month. What should be the next Halloween film that we watch in terms of, like I said, scary, horror, spooky, thriller?
And before you say Stree, research the fact that we've seen that.
Yeah, that style.
Yeah.
Of Stree.
And we've seen Tumbad.
Tumbad.
Yeah.
Amis. Those style of films. Let us know what you think. And
even if they're a campy, scary film. So like Young Frankenstein for American cinema, that counts as a Halloween movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be like scary, scary, horror.
No, it could be campy horror.
But what should be next? And Assamese.
Yeah.
What should be our next Assamese film that we should watch? Let us know down below.